treaty in 1979 and joined AFR after that. First as a student of PhD in astronomy and then as a staff. For the first 25 years he was involved in a variety of space missions that went up on American, Russian and Indian satellites. For the past 15 years he has been interested in the origin of astronomy in India, the topic he has chosen for today's talk. He loves talking to anyone and willing to listen to him. That is also very important, that somebody is willing to listen to others. We welcome Mayank Vahiya. Mr. Sharad Kale, Secretary, YV Savant Center. Mayank Vahiya stays here very close by stone's throw at TIFR Colony. I request Mayank now to begin his lecture.
Yes, sir. I would like. Thank you, guys. I want to first begin by thanking the Yashwantrao Chavan Pratishthan for this invitation. I am very grateful to you, sir. I think last week a friend of mine, Rishikesh Joglekar, last talk was given by Rishikesh Joglekar about some specific aspects of astronomy. What I am going to do is question is, what is the origin of astronomy? Often we all talk about modern astronomy and black holes and galaxies, okay? पण हे सगळं ज्ञान आला कुठून? इट सडनली इट डिंट सडनली अराइज दॅट वी डिंट नो एनिथिंग अँड गॅलिलिओ केम अँड एव्हरीबडी केम टू नो समथिंग. अ लॉट ऑफ डेव्हलपमेंट हॅपन्ड इन एस्ट्रॉनॉमी इनफॅक्ट एव्हरीवेअर आउटसाइड युरोप बिफोर युरोप कुड कॅश इन ऑन दॅट नॉलेज अँड क्रिएट द मॉडर्न एस्ट्रॉनॉमी दॅट वी हॅव टुडे. सो द पॉइंट दॅट आय एम गोइंग टू मेक The point that I'm going to make is to try and talk to you about how astronomy arose, and I'm going to take only Indian example. Ata dusre cultures is par example jahe, but I'm going to stay with Indian examples only. So if you look at the sky always looks very pretty, especially in the night. We Mumbaikars don't have an advantage. The city light is so much that we can't see the sky. But if you really go out, it's a very eye-catching sight. You can't miss, never miss. Light bandh se aana, bandh se. I'm not that handsome anyway. Okay. Night sky has always fascinated human beings and the records of astronomy going back to thousands of years. And I will show you some of the modern examples. Staring at the sky directly or using tools for long enough time has given us lot of new ideas. It has forced us to develop new technologies and it has given us perspective on how the universe is. And the story that I'm going to talk about is the story about how this happened. We largely study our ancestors through material evidence, archaeology vagere karto. But what the suggestion that I have is that studying astronomy actually provides you with a much better tool to understanding our past than what archaeology can give, because the things that archaeology can give but the things that archaeology cannot give with things like astronomy can give. Archaeological data essentially gives you how sophisticated the technology was. It doesn't tell you anything more than that. So for example, if human civilization had died out 50 years ago, nobody would have ever realized that we knew general theory of relativity or special theory of relativity. The technology became available only recently. So technology is way behind what the intellectual capabilities of a civilization are. Intellectual growth of a civilization goes in a variety of ways. There are myths, there is religion, there is literature, there is astronomy and mathematics. And while myths can change, religions evolve, and we'll look at the examples, literature also, if it is not a particularly good literature, tends to get lost. But astronomical knowledge gets accumulated over a period of time. So it is possible to date a lot of things using astronomy and mathematics as a tool. Myths associated with heavens connect literature and astronomy, and all that makes a very rich pool of human knowledge. In early myths, very early, human beings realized that, look, you get food only when there is monsoon. And the moment you realize that, you have this classical association of male and female. So the mother earth has to be fertilized by father sky through rains so that life arises on earth. So mother earth and father sky become a very early mythology. So 30-35,000 years ago, you get statuettes of mother earth and so on. And then of course sky has thunder and lightning, and like all bad fathers, the earth shouts and the sky shouts and screams. And so obviously fathers are in the heavens, and mother nature is gentle, quiet, always supportive of life and all that. And that similarity goes, that actually carries for a long, long time. And in fact, in if you look at religious studies, there's a major question as to when did father become the god. All early religions have mother as a god, but at some stage male dominance must have been so strong that they displaced mothers. So even though we have mother goddesses, in subsequent literature they become secondary to the male counterpart. But in all early religions, it is the mother who dominates, because she is the one who supports life and the father only sends down the rains. So sky is connected by visual patterns of constellations, and that then becomes the next important story, because you want to know, you want to keep track of the sky, and stars look scattered, so you connect them by dots and you make a pattern, and you make small patterns so that you can keep track of it. So you have all kinds of constellations. And then stars are given names of familiar things. Rishis go there and gods go there, and all kinds of things are there. If you look at some of the earliest rock art, for example, this is from Hampi. You have a rock art which now looks a little faded, but you can see a very beautiful complex pattern, and clearly there is some association of death and life and the river of life and the radiation and the bright sun and the dying sun, and you can see the switchover on that. Clearly some artist, and we are still trying to understand this fully, as to why these various intricate patterns have been put to indicate an association of life and death. And this is in the ceiling of one of the caves near Hampi. More common and more easy to understand are drawings like these, where you essentially have a superhuman who controls both the sun and the moon. The great father impression are in fact seen in many rock arts in many civilizations. This is from Kashmir, but you have seen that in Australian rock, Aboriginal rock art, etc., where you can see this mother, the great superhuman god controlling the sun and the moon. Myths and astronomy are closely associated, and their interaction itself is a very fascinating subject. And we will see that myths also change time. So originally people believed that Rahu and Ketu are these two great demons who eat up the sun and the moon. By the time Aryabhatta time comes, he realizes that it is a question of where the earth's movement and the sun's movement intersect, and he calls those points Rahu and Ketu as a continuation of this same story. So even though Rahu and Ketu have completely different meaning after Aryabhatta, the names are the same. So stories evolve, myths evolve, and that makes an interesting set of stories. But we will talk only about astronomy and how fascinating astronomy has been. Evolution of astronomy is, according to me, a fairly exciting and interesting subject to have. There are only a handful of concepts that make up astronomy, actually, the pre-telescopic astronomy. You have the sun, and you have the earth goes around the sun, and because of the fact that the earth's axis is tilted, in June we are right facing the sun, in September 23rd and March 21st we are more or less perpendicular, so we have this 12-hour day and 12-hour night over here and here. And then we have winter on this side and summer on this side. And if you're in southern hemisphere, it's exactly opposite. But this is the first major concept, and that turns in a variety of ways. Okay. The first is that if you're standing on the earth and take the whole picture, essentially the sun seems to move north-south over a period of 1 year. Uttarayana, rather Uttarayana begins from here to here, Dakshinayana begins from here to here, and the sun dances between this 20, minus 23 and a half and 2 plus 23 and a half, Tropic of Cancer to Tropic of Capricorn. And if you sit on the ground and look at it, the picture looks slightly different. You have the human being over here. This is the east, where the sun rises in the east and sets in the west. In winter, the sun rises to the south of east, remains in the sky for very little time, and therefore we have winter. In summer months, the sun rises to the north of east, it remains in the sky much longer, and we have the North Pole over here, and therefore we have summer. So essentially, if you keep track of even the shadow, if you have an east-west facing window in the house, and if you keep a track of the shadow, you will see that over a period of 1 year, that shadow dances, because the sun itself rises in the east and west exactly only twice a year in the two solstice days. Otherwise, it rises to the north or east, north or south of east, and we call it Uttarayana, Dakshinayana, and so on. The other important thing is, of course, the moon, which looms large into the sky. And the moon, of course, waxes and wanes over a period of 29 and a half days. It goes from full moon to new moon to full moon again. And one of the first things that people realize is that roughly when you have 12 full moons, the sun returns roughly to the same condition, same location in the sky. So moon actually goes around the earth in about 29 and a half days. So in 354 days, you have this sun, roughly the sun back to the same location. That's how we have 12 month year. So that 12 month comes from the fact that there are 12 full moons in a year. And so you divided each of them. Unfortunately, the numbers are not exact. You get 12 full moons in 354 days, while the 1 year is 365 days. So you have this 11 day problem. So from early Vedang, Jyotish, etc., there is this problem about how to accommodate this 11 days. The initial practice was that you simply cancel 11 days and start your calendar 11 days later. But that doesn't work if you have an urban civilization where you need a date for every day in order to conduct a transaction. So then they come up with Adhikmas. So every 2.5 years, this 11 day addition comes to about 30 days in a year. So every 2.5 years, we add Adhikmas to synchronize solar and lunar calendar, and therefore we move around. So in one yug, you have two Adhikmas. And so the original concept of yug actually is a 5 year period where two Adhikmas brings you exactly back to the same location. The yuga becoming this gigantic numbers is a subsequent alteration on that, because it seems Lagada in 800 BC or so says that 12 rotations of the sun, or rather five years of rotation of the sun, should make a yuga. And that is mistaken for not 1 day but 1 year. So they multiply that number by 365, and that's why you have this yuga which runs into hundreds of thousands of years. The original concept of yuga is a five-year yuga, when you do two adhikmas and resynchronize your solar calendar perfectly. So if you look at Vedang Joshi, it's a five-year yuga. And then you have the moon itself, of course, does not remain constant. So if the sun is coming from the left, then when the sun and the moon are exactly opposite, you have full moon. When they are together, you have new moon. And then you have phases of the moon. Essentially, this makes up for the basic astronomy of very early period. But then people start noticing complications. They notice that the sun does not rise in the same nakshatra. So what you have on the outer side is the nakshatras. And if you look at the nakshatra carefully, then it rises in Aries during 1 month, and Scorpion is exactly opposite, and so on. So on different months, the sun seems to travel in different patterns of the sky. And the pattern then is divided into 12 patterns. That is how we have 12 rashis or 12 zodiacal signs, because the sun seems to rise in different constellations over a period of 1 year. And that is what the first one that gives us an indication that there is this moon. 12 months does not really make a year, because the sun doesn't read to the same zodiac exactly. And therefore you have to add that Adhikmas and so on. And then there are eclipses, of course, the solar eclipse and lunar eclipse and the other thing. And then when you start noticing the sky more carefully, you notice that only five so-called stars in the sky are not stationary. Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter and Saturn are the only five stars, as it were, that are not constant. And so they were called a variety of names. Planet means the one who moves. It is called Graha is in Sanskrit, because these five of them move. So this five and the sun and the moon make the 7 days of the week. And together we have these five moving things. And then there are beautiful objects like comets, which come and go at random times as they wish, and as they come as they want, they go as they want. And the other phenomena is this shooting stars which periodically fall on Earth. But the last important concept in classical astronomy is this concept. The Earth's rotation is not perfect in the sense it rotates like a top, but it rotates like a badly spinning top. So if you spin a top, initially it is stationary, but then it starts recessing. So the top starts recessing, and that's exactly what happens. So just as a badly recessing top, the Earth also recesses a little. So when you look at the axis of it, it is pointing to the pole star today, but it was pointing at different regions of the sky over a period of time. So it was pointing to Thuban in 3000 BC, it was pointing to Vega in 14,000 years ago, and it goes round and round and round. So pole star becomes pole star only about 300-400 years ago, and it actually was pole star only for one day in late 2017. So the Earth's pointing axis pointed exactly to pole star once. Now it is about 1/4 of a second of an arc, so it's not very far, so we don't notice it. But over a period of time, pole star will cease to be pole star. And eventually we will have a period when there will be no pole star, and then other stars will take over. So when some of the Indian literature was written, it was written between the time when the sun was, the pole axis pointed to pole, between pole star and Thuban. Egyptian architecture is designed to look at Thuban. In Indian architecture, even though we have Dhruva and stories associated with Dhruva, they are much later. In early Vedang, Jyotish, etc., there is no pole star. And I will show you how many cultures are there in India that don't know about pole star, because pole star is a very new thing to have. But this precession does another interesting thing, which is very useful for us when you talk about history of astronomy, which is that the direction of exact east keeps changing. Eventually, direction of exact, if you go back in the drawing, is... So the direction of exact east where the sun rises, if I go here, this is a better picture to take. Okay, this east keeps drifting. Because of the fact that this axis keeps turning, the exact location of the east keeps changing with respect to the stars, and therefore different stars come in exact east. So for example, in Vedic literature, there is a statement that the Pleiades never moved from the east. And that happened 2,500 years ago. Since then, it has moved out. It is no longer the exact east. But the exact east used to be different at different epochs. So, for example, if you looked at the sky in 10,000 BC, the constellation that was in exact east was Leo. In 6,000 BC, it was in Canis Major, and today it is in Pisces. So, it has gone through this drift. Similarly, the summer solstice, when the day and the when you have the sun at the topmost, you have it used to be near Scorpio. Then it went near Virgo, and today it went near Virgo, and today it is near Gemini. And this is recorded in ancient literatures. People over a period of time have recorded saying that this is the constellation that is exactly east, or this is a particular constellation that is associated. That allows you to date ancient documents because of the fact that this is a fairly defined parameter. The simplest way of doing ancient astronomy was to simply put a pole in the ground. Just a pole in the ground, and there's a fancy name for it called gnomon, does a lot of things for you. For example, if I put a gnomon in Mumbai today, then what will happen is that every day the sun rises in the east. The sun rises in the east over here and sets in the west. So as the sun rises in the east, this gnomon will have a shadow which touches this part of the circle. As the sun goes from east to west, this shadow goes in the opposite direction. So you have this direction of every day the sun moves from east to west, and the shadow moves from west to east, and that is our daily clock. Sundials work like that. Over a period of 1 year, because of the fact that sun is moving this north of east and south of east, when the sun is north of east maximum, you have a line which is at the bottom. So summer solstice, the sun will cast a shadow like this. Winter solstice, the sun will cast a shadow like this. And we are scheduled to celebrate the zero shadow day in Mumbai over the next 3-4 days. That is when this shadow will go through exactly this central point. So the rod is in the middle, and the line that comes exactly in the center will cross this, and therefore we have the zero shadow day. It happens twice a year when we get zero shadow, but if you are living to the north of Tropic of Cancer or south of Tropic of Capricorn, you actually never cross the equinox. It's always on the same side, and therefore the shadows are on the same side. But here you have shadows in the south, here you have shadows in the north, and the sun moves like this. Essentially what I mean is that if you have this gnomon and if you have this sun over here, then as the sun moves in this direction, the shadow moves in this direction. So a period of one day you have this movement, or a period of one year you have this movement, and that gives you all the basic calendrical astronomy that you need. Lot of things come from the astronomy. There are surprisingly large number of things. Hours of course come from sun and moon. Day comes from the sunrise and sunset. Week comes from a quarter moon. It's not a natural system of numbers. It is better to have a 6-day week with 24-day month, and then 13 months would give you a year. But 7-day week comes from the moon, because 15 days essentially is full moon to Amavasya and back. So week comes from there. A fortnight of course comes from Amavasya to Purnima and back. A month therefore comes from sun and moon, because 12 full moons almost make a year. A year of course comes from the sun, because the sun runs the weather, and the sun has to be exactly at the same point to give you same weather. 5 years, like I said, comes from synchronization of lunar and solar cycle. But the lunar and solar cycle, you synchronize after 5 years, but there is still, if you're looking at eclipses, then the eclipse repeat is 19-year cycle. So a 19-year cycle comes from there. 60-year cycle comes in many calendars, especially Sumerian calendars, used to not go by the sun and the moon, because that synchronization was tricky. So they used to look at Jupiter and Saturn. So they had a 60-year calendar. And that sexadecimal systems, 360 degrees, etc., multiple roots of 6, comes from the fact that Jupiter and Saturn come together every 60 years. And hundreds of years come from precession, and you can use that knowledge, like I said, and I'll show you the example about how to date these documents. But this much knowledge did not arise instantaneously. So if you look at Aryabhatta period 500 AD, he actually meticulously, mathematically calculates and gives you formulae for everything. And it took till about 500 AD for these things to be properly understood. So acquiring this knowledge of heavens required enormous expenditure of time, resources and intellect and technology by the civilization. It was not something that would occur easily. And they needed memory over hundreds of years to appreciate precession and so on. Cultures required to mature to various levels of development to be able to understand and spare resources to do astronomy. To give a framework to this development, I'm going to define astronomy in 4 different stages. So there is initial stages, and we'll discuss each of them in detail, is simply to realize that sunrise gives you weather, and the location of sunrise gives you what weather it is headache for. Settlement astronomy, when people start farming, they want to know more precisely when the monsoons will come, and therefore they have a more serious astronomy, and they build up huge stone structures, and I will show you some of them, to keep track of when the sun is rising. Astronomy of civilization is more complex, because now people are wondering who they are, why they are on the earth, what is their role on the earth. So a lot more philosophy, a lot of cosmogonical ideas about our relation to the sky, etc. comes in. Some amount of astrology comes in, because everybody is worried about their wealth. So if they can predict the future, or somehow if the predict fortune can be predicted, it will be useful. So the kings in particular would be very keen that the kingdom goes to the sun and stuff like that. So astrology comes into play. And then a more modern astronomy is technology-based multi-wavelength modern astronomy, and we will only briefly touch upon this aspect. By knowing how sophisticated the culture is, I will show you, we can determine how good their intellectual capabilities were, and if you know the intellectual capability, you can say how good their astronomy should be. So if you do nothing and if you just look at sky in wilderness, you will notice that over the horizon the sun rises at equinox point only twice a year. It is summer solstice when it is at the easternmost point, and northernmost point, and winter solstice when it is at the southernmost point. And the sun keeps dancing between these two over the period of 1 year. When it is summer solstice, it is the warmest. When it is winter solstice, it is the closest. And because winter solstice is the time when it is closest, you are all eagerly waiting as to when the sun starts moving northward. And so Uttarayan is an important date. So that is why Dakshinayan we don't celebrate, because the sun is now going south and it's going to be cold. But Uttarayan is a major event in astronomy, because the season will now become warmer, and within 3-4 months of Uttarayan, you can expect, well, within 6 months of Uttarayan, by the time the sun reaches equinox, you can expect monsoons. So that is why there was always an eager celebration of winter solstice. We are talking about people like these. What would they have known? They would have known that sun is the source of warmth and light, which does not require much intelligence. But they are the first ones who would recognize that rains come from the heavens and give us this rejuvenation of the earth. So the sun and sky are identified as constellation. Sky rejuvenates the earth, so it becomes an everlasting image of Mother Earth and Father Sky. And we suspect that even our earlier cousins, Neanderthals and probably Denisovans, etc., also had some vague idea about this Mother Earth and Father Sky and all that. So if you look at the burials of some of the Neanderthals, they have this kind of idea that seems to be floating. Because of its elegance, sky becomes the abode of the gods, and arrival of the first arts by now start showing you evidence, and I'll show you some of the evidences of that. Settling down will bring the first generation astronomy at a level of defining seasons and sunrise points and so on. So this idea of the great superhuman, etc., comes in. One interesting leftover painting from that is this painting in Kashmir, where you have this apparently a scene of hunting, where a doe is being, a deer is being hunted. There's a hunter over here, and there is another person with a spear. And for a long time, I thought that this was simply an uninteresting hunting scene. Except that we got worried about these two suns in the sky, because you can't have two suns in the sky. If the sun, moon is so close to the sun, it'll essentially be in the face towards new moon, so you won't see it. So the argument that we had was that, look, if there are two suns in the sky, and if that have been noted down, then clearly there is something else that has become the sun. And the thing that becomes the sun most obviously is when a star explodes. When a star explodes, it becomes much brighter and can become as bright as the sun or the moon. So our argument was that this painting we know was in a building made 2000 BC, but even in 2000 BC, it was made in such a way that this stone had been used from clearly somewhere else. So the stone artwork must have been much older than 2000 years ago. So our argument was there anything that was as bright as the sun and the moon in the night sky? It should be close to the path of the sun. And it should have happened between 2000 BC and 10,000 BC, because that was the period of the culture. When we did that, to our surprise, we found only one object, a supernova called NG9, which is about 3000 BC, which was in this part of the constellation. And when the supernova went off, when the star exploded, it was much brighter than the moon, but not bright as bright as the sun, but certainly very bright. So the question to ask is, if this is that supernova and this is the path of the sun, and by the way, this is the path of the sun in the sky. So the sun moves like this, and this supernova sits very nicely over here. So the question to ask was whether the rest of the drawing was relevant. And to our great surprise, we found that if you fit Orion over here, and if you take the supernova over here, then Taurus, which we know as a bull in European astronomy, but as a deer in our astronomy, where you have the story of Tulsi. Bilvapatra is being, there's a story about this hunter who wanted to hunt a deer, and the deer said that, look, I have my children, so I want to go and see them before you kill me. Huh? Shivratri story. So there you have this, so this Taurus as a deer is not a strange concept. And this hunter fits very nicely into the Orion at the back. This hunter fits into Taurus. And the rest of the constellations also fit. The path of the sun fits because this is the line of the path of the sun, and the sun would be about 5 degrees off that. So we have a beautiful drawing of a supernova remnant, super star that went off 3000 years ago, recorded in this beautiful stone art in Kashmir, 5000 years ago. And this happens to be the direction of exact east and so on. So we think that this is the earliest recording of an explosion of a star seen by a human being in this environment. The second stage of astronomy becomes more sophisticated when people are worried about farming and all that. So they want to know exactly where the sun rises. So they start making structures like these, and we will look at these megalithic structures in a minute. So by that time, they are making now large structures to keep a track of where the sunrise point has happened, whether Uttarayan is happening, Dakshinayan is happening, how much does the sun have to go further south before it turns and comes northward and so on. So they make large structures to create with astronomy in mind. Various aspects of moon and planets are presumably studied. Constellations, zodiac signs, nakshatras, etc. come into being by now. Eclipses are noticed and attempt is made to figure them out. Transient events like comets are noted. New myths are created to explain observations and so on. And the first ideas of who we are and what the universe is get built up. Megaliths are large structures that are created to study the sunrise pattern, and the megaliths are essentially for calendrical purposes. They are gigantic in size, they are huge structures, and I'll show the example from Udupi region. In Western context, they are shown to be astronomical use. So if you go to Stonehenge, etc., we know they are of astronomical use, and I'll show you that Indian megaliths are also astronomical. And India has some 2000 or more such structures. And I'm going to take example of only one of them. So there is a place called Vaise, about 200 kilometers north of Udupi, where you have a whole bunch of stone structures lying there. And in this particular part is of great interest to us because there you have huge stones, several meter tall stones, which have been set up. This one is broken. That is why it is not as tall as this. But essentially you have these huge stone structures. If you just go there and look at the stone structures, they appear random. There seems to be no pattern. Any stone seems to have been put anywhere. But if you go back and simulate it, and somebody called Sri Kumar Menon did it, what he finds is that if you look at the shadow of each of these stones, then only on summer solstice does the shadow of one stone touch another stone. Manje, somebody had put one stone, studied its shadow, and wherever at summer solstice the shadow went, the second stone was put. And it's a symmetrical situation. So summer solstice in one direction, winter solstice in the other direction. So what you have in black line are the shadows of these stones, and this stone was particularly large, this stone is small, and so on, and there's a corresponding other stone that it meets. In most of the cases, we have the shadow of one stone meeting the other stone when it is exactly in the range. So this is an observatory that was created with repeated attempts, and you could determine the winter solstice, summer solstice, and the movement of the sun by just going to that place. By just going to that place and looking at the shadows of how they move. So this we have subsequently several examples of this kind. And when temple architecture comes in, temples are essentially done astronomically. They are always marked exactly in the east. If you go to any well-constructed temple, you have this Vajrasambha right in the entrance of the temple, and that is what decides the direction. And that is exactly a gnomon which they use to define the direction of the temple landmark. And then they build the temple according to what I know. In most cases, at least in solar temples, it's exactly east-west. In some temples, they are meant for a specific celebration. So there is Marthandey temple in Kashmir, for example, which is designed to slightly offset in such a way that during the harvesting season, the sun's, the Shiva's ling is illuminated. So the Shivling is illuminated and the harvesting happens. And by the time you finish with harvesting, the door structure is such that the shadow no longer falls on the shivling. But this is the basis of that kind of architecture. And then of course, Vedang Jyotish itself says that just as the jewel of a peacock is its beauty, so is astronomy, Jyotisha, the auxiliary of the great Vedas. So we have this basic idea of Vedas. Both you, Rugveda and Yajurveda, have their own Vedang Jyotish and their own astronomy. And they struggle with this idea of 11 day difference between 12 full moons and 365 days, and they talk about how to add adhik mass and what are the rules and stuff like that. They also have some ideas of basic constellations and stars and so on. But their calendrical system is very accurate. You would get exactly 365 and a quarter days a year if you followed their formulation. They are aware of the discrepancies between solar and lunar month and intercalary month and how to synchronize that. Then philosophy comes in. So if you look at Rigveda, there's a very famous shloka called Nasadiya Sukta. And Nasadiya Sukta goes beautifully about who we are and where we are. So what was wrapping, where and in whose protection. I don't have time to go through this, but if you really have even 15 minutes of slight time to spare, please go and look at Nasadiya Sukta. It's one of the most beautiful pieces of poetry that exists there. So they wonder where the universe came from and what creates it. And then he says essentially that there was nothing. I'm not even reproduce the whole of it. I've skipped some of the part of it. And then at the end of it, they say, who really knows? Who can presume to tell it all? And when whence was it born and whence was it created? And that says that out of which create. And they say even gods do not know because gods come later. Now in most religions, gods are omnipresent. NASA gave Sukta for the first time says that even gods came after the great God had created the universe. And then they say, who knows? Maybe the one who surveys the great heavens knows. And then they doubt whether he is aware of how he created the universe. Because the universe, it says, is created from his own pure ardor, is the word he uses, from which his own impulse it comes. So even probably he is not aware of how this impulse of his created the universe itself. And a whole bunch of later Hindu concepts of Dvaita, Advaita, periodicity of cycles, a whole bunch of concepts can be seen as the earliest representation is in NASA Deosukha. So you have very philosophical, very, very profound philosophical ideas that come by this time. And then there's another thing that we did, which is to study tribal astronomy. The reason for studying tribal astronomy is that the mainstream astronomy essentially was decided in Sumeria in 3000 BC, and we follow the same constellations and same nakshatras. Rashis are Indian, but nakshatras and zodiacal signs are essentially decided by, sorry, Rashis and zodiacal signs are decided by the Sumerians, nakshatras are Indian, because we were more obsessed with moon than they were. So we study tribal astronomy to see how other kinds of astronomies can be. And the tribes that we studied, we now have, I'm very proud to say that we have studied 8 different tribes, including most recently tribes in Nicobar Island. But other tribes are largely in central Maharashtra, near Nagpur region, and all that except Chol Nayakas, who are in Kerala, and who in fact only 135 of them survived. Until about 30 years ago, they didn't even wear clothes. They are that isolated. The government keeps them isolated. Not even government officers are allowed to meet them. Once every week, they, by a mutual agreement, they come 5-6 kilometers down from their habitation to a riverside where they are given food, etc., and whatever they may need. And once a year, a handful of them are brought to Trivandrum for meet interaction and just to see the city. That's how we could interact with them, because you're not allowed to go where they are. The last of the great cavemen of India or the world, maybe. So Chol Nayaka is interesting. Others are Gonds, for example, are one of the most powerful tribes of Maharashtra and so on. So we had these various tribes and we found some interesting things. This is our Saptarshi, and that is known to most of the tribes, but in completely different formats. This Saptarshi we now know points to the pole star. This is a picture that they saw thousands of years ago. Today this vector points to the pole star. So we all know Dhruv Tara over here and Saptarshi over here. To them it is nothing like that. To Andamanis, this is a place, manner in which you save the hen. So the hen is kept in this basket in a big structure that is like this, which is kept on stilts, so that there is only one ladder to access the hen, so that the hens are safe from other animals and snakes and stuff like that. To the Gonds and the tribes of central Maharashtra, this is a cot on which an old lady sits, and there are these three thieves that are trying to steal this cot. And the lady's cot is made of precious stone, a precious metal. So if the lady goes to sleep, essentially the thieves will steal the bed. So they have this concept that this lady sleeping over here these three thieves should not be allowed to steal this thing. So essentially the idea is that this cot should never go under the sky. It should always remain in the sky so that the old lady does not sleep. Today, if you go to Nagpur region and look at the sky, this constellation dips and rises again. So there are times when this lady is asleep, as it were, according to Nagpur people, according to Gonds. But in 1000 BC, until 1000 BC in Nagpur area, because of precession, this constellation never set. It was always in the sky. So the memory that they have, the Gonds have, is a memory of the sky observation that makes it back to 1000 BC. Because since 1000 BC, this lady no longer remains in the sky. She goes to sleep. To other tribes, this has a variety of meaning. So if you look at Gonds, Banjaras and others of central Maharashtra, they have this idea of cot. There are others who have a hen house there. There are others who have a variety of objects sitting there. There are servants sitting there. There are slaves sitting there. There is, in many cases, it is not even a cot. There are different constructs there. In classical Hindu mythology, we have the 7 priests. 6 of them are alone. This one is a double star, so Arundhati stays with him, and the others go and become Pleiades. Anyway, so there are stories like this that you can pick up from various places, which actually allows you in this case to date the astronomy to 1000 BC. And the fact that none of them know pole star except the Andamanese, Nicobaris, essentially means that their knowledge is frozen. Nicobaris, on the other hand, they have to use the sky for their travel and stuff like that. So they are aware of changing star constellations. So they know the pole star is in the northern direction. They know Crux is the southern direction, so on. So they are more dynamic in their observations. Many of the cultures who don't need the sky only have ancient knowledge. Then the other interesting region is this, which I find very fascinating. There is Auriga over here. There is Gemini over here. There is Taurus over here. There is Lippus over here. There is Sirius over here. And there is Taurus the bull and Pleiades. And each of them have a story. So this is supposed to be a great well from which water is drawn for their farming. They are essentially farmers. This, or rather I should have pointed out, this is the farming sequence. So this is the plow. These are the two bullocks that are running, that are dragging the plow. And this is the farmer who is driving this. So this is entirely a plow. Over here you have a place where the women are carrying this water for farming. Over here you have a place where the rice, where the dhan is collected and the husk is removed from the seeds. Over here you have a basket where you collect that dhan and store it for the time being. Over here they see a bird and the bird nest with eggs in it who are trying to eat up the seeds. So they have Pleiades, which can be anything, which has a large variety of names, and I'll show you Pleiades as a specific example of how different cultures look at it. But Pleiades in some ways is supposed to be the set of stones that are thrown by the farmers to shoo away this bird so that it doesn't come and eat up the harvest. So essentially the whole thing is one beautiful, magnificent harvesting scene. This constellation incidentally begins conspicuously to rise in October, November, and by April, May, just as farming actually begins, this sets. So the idea is to remember these ideas and working of farming. Many of the tools are designed according to astronomy. So especially Saptarshi has inspired many of the farming tools. In Pardi, the Taurus is used as a tool to catch the set of birds that are at Pleiades, and they actually on the ground use a net which is essentially a funnel and funnel all the birds into it and catch them at the other end because the other end is blocked. So it's inspired entirely by Taurus. So various tribes have various interesting and fascinating stories to tell about the tribes. But Pleiades in particular I'm interested in. I'm sorry this has come here. Banjaras are essentially businessmen. So to them, the Pleiades is a piece of jewelry that women wear on the head. The same Pleiades for Kolam and Pardi is a flock of birds. They are essentially tribes that depend on foraging in the forest. So to them, this is a set of beautiful birds that are flying around. And depending on which flocks of birds they see, they give different names. To Korku, who are essentially animal eaters, this is minced meat, which is a delicacy for them. To Gonds, who are essentially farmers, this is the dhoka they use to separate husk from the grain. To the Varlis, who are essentially, they are known for their painting and all, to them this looks like a diva that is lighted at night to allow them to do their work. To the Nicobaris, some Nicobaris, it looks like the great king who is sitting there because the majestic Akash Ganga is right in front of them. So they see the great king running his kingdom. To some other Nicobaris, this is a place where the ancestors sit because the Akash Ganga goes close to that. So the ancestors, when they die, they go along the Akash Ganga and then they all settle down in Pleiades. And classical view, of course, is that these are the seven wives of Saptarishis that make the Saptarshi Katsar. So the same set of objects, same object in the sky looks very different depending on what your cultural perspective is, on how you imagine it. The other interesting constellation that people see are Scorpio and this Crux and Centaurus, which is exact south. So this point is exact south. There is no southern, there is no pole star in the south, but roughly this is the exact south southern region. And Nicobaris, for example, use it for direction finding and so on. So amongst all the constellations in the sky, there are lots of constellations. This is the hunting scene that I told you about. Milky Way is the great path on which the ancestors move, or the whatever animals move. In some cases, they also see the path in which a family moves and the daughter-in-law is coming from the opposite side and the father, the great jet is coming on one side. So the younger wife has to go away on a slide because this Milky Way has a lot of paths inside it because of dust. So they actually have this parts in which different parts of the family move and stuff like that. It makes a fascinating story of its own, right? In fact, if many of you, if you ask your grandparents, they will tell you stories of this kind, not the modern astronomy kind. Then you come to astronomy of the civilization. I still have 10 minutes. Okay. Then you have astronomy of civilization. And by this time, astronomical mythologies become more formal. Astrology comes in, cosmology comes in. In the absence of knowing why these things happen, the person who can read the stars becomes very important. So the astrologer becomes very important. There is also reinterpretation of the older myths and so on, and more sophisticated speculations exist. Again, I will show you a little. And there's an interesting mix of the religious beliefs, astronomy and architecture. And I will show you examples of temples and so on. Some amount of mathematical astronomy arises here. That is when they start getting these exact calendars and so on. There's a city of Dholavira, which is a Harappan city, which is in Kutch region of India, one of the two large cities of Harappan civilization. And I'm going to skip this part of the story. It is now reconstructed to look like this, but there's an interesting structure over there, and that interesting structure faces exactly north south on a slope. It is essentially in this part. This is where the kings presumably lived, and on this part there is a structure which essentially looks like a building which has not been completed. Harappans are such beautiful, such great architects that they could not possibly have made a mistake like this. And then if you put a roof on this, and because of the fact that this faces exactly north-south, and because of the fact that Harappa, Dholavira is exactly on the Tropic of Cancer, and if you make a hole in the roof, then the shadow moves along this line, reaching the top edge to bottom edge, exactly over the period of 1 year. So you have to just put a log and make a marking, and you could use it as a calendar. And the reason why this split is there is because, to double check, because summer solstice, or this shadow breaks exactly in such a way that the other part of the sun's shadow touches the other side. So you can see the sun coming along like this, and suddenly it splits into two. The second one illuminates this part of the wall, and then the sun moves out as the day has gone. So the east is on this side, west is on this side, sorry, and this is exactly north-south. So the sun moves like that. So they had simple, straightforward calendar, and there are two such structures. Sorry. And this is what I mean, that on winter solstice, the shadow would come exactly touch on this edge and go away. So if winter solstice would touch here, summer solstice would touch there, if you had a 2 meter high roof on that. And you can simulate and show that this is exactly what happens. Then there are punchmark coins, which were little coins, were half an inch in size, but they needed signs. And there you can see all kinds of signs. You can naturally see sun, and you can see Pleiades and stuff like that. But there are more interesting things that you can see. Rock art, this essentially the second urbanization of India, in the Harappa, in the Gangetic plain, you get a lot of these civilizations where you get panchmark coins. These are all Janapadas of the Gangetic plain. You get these panchmark coins, and there are clearly panchmark coins with something on the back of that object, which seems to suggest star, and they typically have 6 or 7 points on that. So we suspect that all of them are symbols for Pleiades. And the reason why Pleiades and moon in part, there's Pleiades and moon. So there are a whole bunch of pictures of Pleiades, but there are interestingly some here with Pleiades and moon. And Pleiades and moon meet each other only once in 18 years. It is not an annual feature. Every 18 years, moon passes close to Pleiades. And typically in a king's life, it would happen once in a lifetime. So they have essentially celebrated the Pleiades and moon association in several sun signs, or several punchmark signs on these various coins. Cosmogony of Upanishads. So in Upanishads, there is an interesting discussion between Yajnavalkya and Gargi. And Gargi asks, what is the universe made of? And then there's a series of arguments which are worth going through. So Gargi says, Yajnavalkya says the earth is wrapped by water. He says, fine. What is water wrapped by? He says air. What is air wrapped by? He says sky. And the argument goes on. So sky is Gandharvas. Gandharvas is sun. Sun is the moon. The moon, world of moon is nakshatras. The world of nakshatras is devas. World of devas is Indra. World of Indra is Prajapati. And world of Prajapati is Brahman. And then Gargi asks what next. Yajnavalkya loses his temper and tells her to shut up. But essentially you have, and if you sort of, I mean, these are abstract ones. But if you look at this sequence, except Moon, nothing is really out of order. Okay? You essentially, if you put Moon over here, after Sky, if you put the Moon, you get a fairly accurate sequencing of how the Sky moves. But there are ideas and philosophies and so on. Temples in particular I want to take. Can I overshoot by 5 minutes? So temples arise in India in 500 BC as a reaction to Buddhism. There is no temple in Vedic literature. And Vedic literature is very clear that you do your havan and then move out. You do not make that place as a place of worship permanently. You're supposed to move forward because essentially it is nomadic groups. By 500 BC, Hinduism gets into this decadence and then Buddhism comes up. And when Buddhism, and the death of Buddha, they make stupas. And that very quickly become a place where you can collect your religious flock and so on. And the Hindus realize that, look, this is a good way of associating, sort of keeping your flock together and spreading your religion. So temples come into Hinduism around 500 BC as a reaction to Buddhism. Its origin is essentially sepulchral, because the old stupas had the hair and body remains of Buddha and so on. But they have specific orientation and an entrance window to sunlight. Architecturally, temples represent the great cosmos from the sky, and they are an extension of the megalithic architecture which they already knew, except that they now adopted for religion. So essentially it represents cosmos in microcosm. There are two major styles of temples in India, Nagara and Dravidian. There are some combinations there. So Dravidian style essentially has this huge entrances, Dwarapas, and the Garbhagriha itself. The central place is not very conspicuous. The Nagara style have a very conspicuous Garbhagriha where the great god himself resides. And then there are these one or two halls depending on which temple you are talking about. The first one where the king is allowed to go, inside only the Brahmin is allowed to go, and the various cultural programs that happen on the outer side. But if you look at the central basis of that, the slide is missing. If you look at the central Garbhagriha where the great god sits, then the god is in one place and all the quarters are defined according to Rashis and Nakshatras and the great Dwarpas. So there is Ishan, Agni, Nairutva, Vayavya. And Agni is supposed to sit in one location, and all the peripheral gods are defined in precise manner in which they are supposed to sit. And that is essentially because the temple is supposed to represent this great cosmos or the sky in which the god remains. So his representation is brought on the ground. The temples are consecrated like that. So they are brought on the ground, and that is why you worship them on the ground. But you can see clear astronomical. So these are essentially like those great megalithic structures where the shadows spread aside. And they are north, south, east, west oriented, and there is a gnomon in all these temples. There are other interesting signatures that are. In Vedic literature, there is a discussion that Saptarshi calendar was in Purva Falguni or something. I'll come to that. And we know the stars don't move, so it is not that Saptarshi went from one constellation to another constellation. It makes no sense. But yet, when Parikshit takes over the reins of Hastinapur after the great Mahabharata war, it says that the Saptarshi calendar was so and so, and it made no sense. So we went back and looked at the original literature, and the original literature is fairly precise. It very clearly defined that you take the first two stars of the Saptarshi and take the point in the sky that does not move. And if you bisect this vector, whichever nakshatra it meets is the house of Saptarshi. And so in 2100 BC, it was Pushya. In 2000 AD, it is Purva Falguni. I can't read the word over here. Anyway, but during the reign of when Parikshit takes over the kingdom, the Saptarshi house, Saptarshi is supposed to be this house, which gives you exactly, it is in Magha, essentially. Saptarshi is in Magha, and that happens around 1300 BC, which is a date for Mahabharata, which is agreed from a variety of other pieces of evidence. 1300 BC. So 3,500. So that matches very well. And what happens is that during this period, Saptarshi actually changes house every 100 years. So they have made that calendar of 100 years, realizing this vector moves. Then beyond that, it starts becoming slower. It takes much longer time to go from the subsequent nakshatra. So they abandon the calendar, realizing that it is not proper. But during this time, they clearly say the Saptarshi calendar is Magha, and that gives you 1300 BC. So there are various places where literature, where this astronomical knowledge is recorded. So Brihat Samhita, for example, talks about Rohini Shakadbe, which happened in 5000 BC. So we suspect that's an ancient memory. Because if you look at Yajurved itself, it says the vernal equinox is in Kritika, which comes to 2030 BC. Yajurvedang Jyotish talks about summer solstice being in Ashlesha, and that gives you 1370 BC. Lagada clearly says that polar latitude of Shravishta he gives, and that gives you 1340 BC. Mahabharat, like I said, the Saptarshi calendar gives you 12 to 1300 BC. Parashar Samhita talks about the description of seasons and the constellations that are connected with that, and that gives you 11 to 1300 BC. You can actually date ancient calendars because the astronomical observations are so accurately done. Last that brings me is to modern astronomy. There is not much to say in that. It essentially arises when technological sophistry becomes really complex and people have enough spare, there's a proper intellectual traditions and so on. In India, this modern astronomy begins with Siddhantic period 500 AD when Aryabhat writes the first encyclopedia of astronomical knowledge, and he collects all the ideas and equations and then develops mathematics and so on. So 500 AD is the exact day on which, or exact year in which Siddhantic astronomy begins, where you have this noting. So preoccupation of astronomers now is to calculate the planets and so on. I'll skip a bit of this because I want to show you. This is the syllabus for who can be an astronomer according to Varahamihira, 505 AD. And I want you to note the kind of things that they are expected to know. An astronomer is expected to know the time division into yuga, year, solstices, seasons, month, fortnight, day, night, all the way down to a few milliseconds. It's not clear how they measured it. They go to Nadi and then they divide the Nadi into further time. They are supposed to planetary calendar, Saura calendar, and including look at the retrograde motion of planets and so on. They are supposed to know the terrestrial calendar. They are supposed to be able to calculate solstices. They are supposed to be able to calculate eclipses. And they are supposed to be able to say talk about sun's daily and annual motion. They are supposed to calculate the latitude and longitude at every place, starting with Ujjain as the zero longitude, and then nakshatras and zodiacs and so on. And then the last line is that they should be able to teach it to a smart student. The interesting thing is, it involves so much more, is the fact that it does not involve astrology. It does not say that he should be able to predict the future. Because astronomy actually is a later addition to Indian culture. It comes from the Greeks. So in this Yavana Samhita that is written around that time, which records the great thoughts of the Greeks, for the first time brings astronomical astrology into India. But Varahamihira does not feel that an astronomer should know astrology. Then of course you have Jantar Mantar, and today's astronomy is dependent on telescopes and all kinds of other things. The bottom line is that you have this initial phase of astronomy, you have this settlement astronomy, you have this astronomy of civilization, and then you have technology. But you can do something more than that, and I'll just take a couple of minutes more to do that. What I have here is various cultures and the period since the time they have settled down, and then you can quantify how much astronomy they knew, and to give a sort of qualitative value to how much astronomy they knew. And if you plot the periods in civilization to the level of astronomy they knew, you get a beautiful correlation to show that the more settled you are, the more astronomy you will know. So if you know how settled the culture is, you should be able to predict how much astronomy it should know. If you know their astronomical knowledge, you should say that they must have been settled for some time. The bottom line is that you can define major intellectual periods. For initial steps in India, you would put it between 50,000 and 5,000 BC. Settlement period is between 5,000 and 2,500 BC. For Vedic culture, it comes slightly later. So this is for the Harappans. By 2500, they become urbanized. For astronomy of civilization, so Harappans should have known a fair amount of astronomy, which we don't understand for the moment. But if you look at Upanishad and Puranic astronomy, it's an astronomy of a civilization. And technology-based astronomy, like I said, comes from 500 AD. The bottom line is that it is possible to create a map of intellectual growth of a civilization using astronomy as a probe. The growth of astronomy occurs in distinct stages, which are dramatically different, and you can catch each of these. These stages can be considered analogous to the kind of sudden changes in culture that we have, the disruptive changes in the culture. Often these archaeological evidences does not show these dramatic changes. You have to be really careful to look at it. And astronomy therefore provides another window to our understanding the past. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, you can ask. At the moment, I can't answer. No, yeah, I understand.
I think looking to the big crowd today, he has provoked you enough.
So normally we request you to ask 5 questions. Today we will allow you to ask 7 questions.
So you can ask as many.
Questions?
Yes, sir.
You said Varaha Mir is 5000 BC.
505 AD. 505 AD.
No, the Gurat Samhita.
It's 500 AD.
Take
a minute.
I thought you started from that.
No, Vedang Jyotish is what I started with as far as literature is concerned. Varaha Mir is 505 AD.
You had another of the charts.
That was charts. Okay, that table you are talking about. Just 1 minute.
I think Gurat Samhita also.
No, sorry. Yeah, no, I'll do this. This is the slide you are looking at.
Okay.
This is Gurat Samhita.
Yes, there are the modern Gurat Samhita. Is probably an augmented version of the older one. So we have that for 2 or 3 documents, but they have been subsequently altered. The original mentioned something called Rohini Shakatved, which is supposed to be very dangerous. When Rohini, and it says they are not very clear. So it's Rohini is the base of Taurus. And it says that when either Mars or Jupiter, they are not very clear which, Mars or Saturn, is inside Rohini, when the Rohini Shakat is essentially, it is broken, disaster happens. And there is no astronomy software in India that allows you to do that. All these packages software don't go beyond 3000 BC. So, we contacted somebody in NASA who does this interplanetary motions, missions and stuff like that. So, they calculated for us and they said the last time the Rohini Shakatved had happened was in 5000 BC and that was Mars. Mars had gone through Rohini and that was the time when the sea level changes were so severe that the sea was coming in at the rate of 1 meter every week. Suddenly, within a period of 10 years, the sea level rises by 120 meters, between around 5000 AD.
Within a period of?
Within a period of a few decades, the sea level rises by 120 meters, not centimeters, meters. Okay? And so, if you are living in inland, the sea starts coming in. That is when Dwarka, for example, goes underneath and so on. So, that happens. So we suspect that they saw this unusual Rohini Shakatved. So in fact, they don't use the word disaster, they use the word pralaya, which essentially means a global catastrophe. And we suspect that that is what is recorded. And we also suspect that Gurat Samhita itself can't be that old, because the linguistically it is not that old. So it is an ancient memory of a major disaster that must have remained in the memory like the Gauls who remember the Saptarshi was never supposed to set. So an ancient memory of such a catastrophic event has been recorded subsequently. That is our belief. So that is that the original Dwarka that went underneath is much older. Then subsequently the sea level, but there has been subsequent sea level rises. Now of course again sea level rise is happening right now. And if you are not careful, Mumbai might go under.
And that's so where those things are. We are allowing people to be closer to the coast.
Exactly. Yes. Thank you very much. Yes, exactly. It's quite silly. It is quite silly. But essentially, the other documents are contemporaneous. So, it is Yajurveda observation we think happened at the time when they were writing Yajurveda. 2300 BC seems to be quite a reasonable date.
More?
Yes.
So we discussed also the Indian context. The question is, here in India we celebrate the Makar Sankranti. Is there any country to celebrate this event and celebrate the Makar Sankranti?
Yes. So Makar Sankranti, by the way, is still on 16th of January that we celebrate. But Uttarayan is no longer there now. Okay. Uttarayan now happens on 21st December. But Uttarayan happened when sun entered Makar, which is what Makar Sankranti is. That the sun entry into Makar Rashi is Makar Sankranti. And that still happens on 14th of January, whatever that Uttarayan, Makar Sankranti date is. But it is no longer Uttarayan. Okay, there is a difference.
Yeah.
And that split happened, that coincidence happened about 1300 AD or so. That is when they must have decided that Uttarayan should be celebrated. Uttarayan should be celebrated. And when the sun enters Makar, we shall celebrate Uttarayan, because that is when Uttarayan is happening. Subsequent to that, precession has been there.
So when was that together?
1300 AD. Around 1300 AD. AD. So it's just fairly recent. Uttarayan, Makar Sankranti. Because for example, Dhruva Tara becomes Uttara only conspicuous in recent times, and yet it is noted. So many of these new astronomical concepts are continuously added into the literature. Yes. Sorry, just to complete that answer, I don't know whether in summer, southern hemisphere must be celebrating Dakshinayan.
So it
would
be 40th of July or something.
Something, 6 months later, yes. I don't know. The problem is that most of the habitation of southern hemisphere has happened in recent time, and the great tribals of aboriginals of olden times. The older aboriginals essentially in Australia have been nearly wiped out. In New Zealand, some of them remain. And in America, in southern America also, they have been largely wiped out. So Chile has no tribal population. So very little of that knowledge remains. And I don't think Dakshinayan is celebrated. Sorry? Well, they don't celebrate Dakshinayan in a formal manner, saying okay, the sun. So they are sensitive to seasons, as far as I know. And so there's a particular season in which a particular fruit arises, and that fruit is nicely fermented. So when the birds eat it, that fruit is so fermented with alcohol essentially. So they get zonked off by that alcohol and they fall down. So that is the time when it's most easy to catch these birds. Those kind of things they celebrate. But whether they have this formal Uttarayan and Dakshinayan, because they never reach this level of sophistication also. Yes. ट्रायबल एस्ट्रॉनॉमी मी सांगितलं, ट्रायबल्सना सगळ्यांना शूटिंग स्टार्स माहिती आहे. आता शूटिंग स्टार्स काय आहे त्याची स्टोरी वेगवेगळी आहे, पण अंदमानमध्ये ते लोक म्हणतात की देव खाली येतात, गोंड म्हणतात की नो नो वेन गॉड एम्प्टीज हिज टॉयलेट्स दॅट इज वेर यू गेट इट, दुसरे कोणी म्हणतात की तिथे देर इज वॉर बिटवीन गॉड्स अँड राक्षस अँड सब लाइक दॅट, आणखी ते मेलेले सोर्सेस पडतात वगैरे. सो द आयडिया दॅट देर इज शूटिंग स्टार दॅट लाईट्स अप अँड इल्युमिनेशन फॉल्स ऑन द अर्थ इज ऑब्झर्व्ह व्हेरी अर्ली. Even the most primitive of tribes that we saw, no shooting stars. Yes.
Uttarayan and
Dakshinayan
are opposite in the both hemispheres.
Yes. So our Uttarayan is there, but Uttarayan and Dakshinayan is the same, but the effect is different. So we celebrate Uttarayan because we start getting warmer. They should celebrate Dakshinayan because that is when the south starts becoming warmer.
And sir, because Uttarayan starts after the winter solstice.
Correct. And it starts with their summer solstice. So after summer solstice, the sun starts moving north.
Opposite.
Exactly.
And sir, I didn't understand the yuga. 5 years
by season. Yeah. I didn't understand. See, what happens is there is 29 and a half days between full moon to full moon. Okay? So if you take my 1 year to be one, full moon to full moon is 1 month, second full moon to full moon is 2 months, etc. In 354 days, I will come to 1 year. But Surya tithe aala nahi. So the seasons have not really returned. It's going to be another 11 days before the sun returns to the original season. So that Akra Divas, either you catch it in the beginning and simply bong them off. Then there's even in Vedanta Jyotish, there's an attempt to say that nothing doing, we will have 30 day months. But then they have 360 days and they still lack 5 days, and then the 5 days are left blank. So Vedanta Jyotish ties various kinds of calendars. And one of the suggestions is that simply do 360 days, forget 5 days and start again. Sorry. So, you have anyway, so if you do 12 full moons, you have this 11 day surplus. But you cannot really correct it. So, you don't want to correct it and you continue. After 30 months, now the difference has become so much that it is a 1 month equivalent. So, you add one more month. So, after 30 months, you add one more month. So, every 2.5 years, you add one more month so that the sun and the moon are now together. And that you do, in 5 years, you do it after 60 months.
Now we calculate as
Adhik Maas is once in 3 years. 2.5. Ajun Pat 2.5
Was that other half is part of a year?
Yes. So in the third year, every third year you
once
have,
in
yes.
Yes. Earlier, they used to have 2 months in 5 years.
Huh. So it's a question of, so probably it is true. Yeah, I'm not exactly sensitive to this.
So in 5 years it becomes, yeah, 60 years,
right? Either a year every, and every 2.5 years, or at 2 months after 5 years. So for example, even the one place where we still follow our Vedic Hinduism is when we have this Shraddha and stuff like that. And if you go to a Brahmin and if you do your Varshi, the Brahmin will actually tell you that if you're really religious minded, you should do it for 5 years, for the entire yoga in which your ancestor died. So you have to finish that yoga before you stop doing your individual ancestor worship. Then you go into this common worship of ancestors. Yes.
All this history, where exactly magnetism and gravitation came in picture?
Magnetism and gravitation both come to us from the West. Gravitation, yes, it's a modern astronomy. Both of the things, there are no formals. See, one of the things, one of the great tragedies of Indian science is that, and I'm sorry if I upset somebody, is that one of the problems that we have had right from Mahabharata period is that the intellectual traditions never work with their hands. So this connection between artisan and their sciences and the great intellectual traditions never merged. Okay, so artisans did fantastic work. Building Taj Mahal is not a trivial thing, and building Harappan civilization is not trivial. Building these great temples is not trivial. But the formal intellectuals never sat and studied the traditions and studied the properties, etc. So we missed out on that classical way. If we had got Newton's laws of motion, we had the algebra to do it, but we never applied it. So if we had got Newton's laws of motion, etc., we would have come up to gravitation, but we never went there. That entire area we never studied, and so we have had this great.
But that was present at that ancient time.
No, gravity is for the first time defined by Newton.
Yeah, but that was there already. No, in Mahabharata period, gravitation.
Gravity is everywhere. I mean, for since the birth of the universe, 17.5 billion years ago, gravity has been around.
We can give it.
But yeah, but so gravity has always been there. But the idea, the realization that gravity, for example, gravity, if you're physics minded, it goes as g1 g2 by r square. Now why is it not r cube and why is it not r is something that Newton really worries about, and at the end of it eventually comes out because of the fact that elliptical motions and all that, he says no, it is r square. But there's a major discussion on that. Those kind of discussion didn't happen in Indian complex. That was a tragedy.
Do we have any discussion? What was the, did they think, what are these sparkling points which we are seeing in the sky? Can we call it a star or a galore? What is it? Did they distinguish between graha and tara?
Well, the new grahas move and taras don't move. But they didn't ask why. See, what happened was, at the end of the, as had happened in every culture, is that at some stage religion takes over. And religious beliefs are so small, and that is because God said this should happen, this should happen. So breaking that tradition was very difficult. In India, what these great scholars did was simply say that, okay, fine, the universe is created by the great gods and all that, but it still has rhythms. And I agree with you that I can never know the great will of the god, but I can get approximate formulations. So they only said, okay, this formula works. So when they calculate the planetary motions, etc., they only say that this formula works to give you the planet. They don't worry about the epicycle and the epicycle on cycle on epicycle, all that the Greeks did. They don't worry about that. In fact, poor Aryabhatta actually speculates on these things. He says that maybe, just as a boat moving forward thinks that the rest of the world is moving backwards, maybe the earth is spinning and the rest of the sky is focused. And he gets terribly ridiculed by Varahamihira himself, saying that what's a silly thing it is, because if the bird goes up, it will not be able to come down. If you throw something up, if the earth moves in the earth, you know, usual arguments against this thing. So he himself gets criticized. So the idea of physical association to mathematics is an idea that we never really fully explored, and which is why we miss some of the great things.
The same example is in Nanishwari.
Yes. Yes.
Which you mentioned about Aryabhatta.
Yes. So, but it is a
15th, 5th century, in the 13th century.
Yes. In 5th century, Aryabhatta says that, look, maybe the earth is spinning. But he's ridiculed. But you can see these arguments and discussions in the literature. That is where the fun is.
But the calendar which comes from your calculations is different from
Okay, now that you have, excuse me for speaking longer.
How Vedas were 5000 years old.
Yes. Personally, I think these dates that come from astronomy are fairly accurate. Varahamihira, for example, gives an exact formula about how to calculate Gudi Padwa and the days from Gudi Padwa. Okay, so if you tell me that what 318 days 500 years ago, what Rashi was it? In principle, you can use this. What Rashi was at what time? In principle, you can use Varahamihira's formulation to calculate. But Varahamihira's formulation, so we did the simple thing. Take Varahamihira's Gudi Padwa and calculate dates all around. And eclipse happens only when it is full moon or new moon, depending on which eclipse you talk about. And NASA has very accurate calculations of eclipses from 3000 BC to 3000 AD. So we took Varahamihira's calculations and said that was it a new moon or a full moon on the eclipse? Does Varahamihira predict a full moon or a new moon when you have an eclipse? And for about 400 years around his formulation, he works beautifully. It's extremely accurate. But beyond that, because of precession, it starts drifting away. To the extent that Varahamihira and Aryabhata were actually aware of this, and they, the way of the formula requires, if you want to extend the formula, requires a sine table. Even the formula itself requires a sine and cosine trigonometric table. So he gives it as a lookup table. But he warns the observer very clearly that this is probably a limited application because we don't know the will of the god. So you better keep on measuring regularly and changing these parameters, as he warns explicitly. But it works for about 400-500 years. You get new moon and full moon on eclipses. But then it starts getting error, and the error gets bigger as you go further. And there's a single sine function that would have to be added to do that. So if Varahamihira had been reborn after 500 years, he would have added that sine term. But people were sensitive to precession because they've noted that the exact east is Pleiades. They've noted that this exact east seems to be drifting, so they very carefully note it down. That you see.
And it were from Brahmagupta or Bhaskaracharya,
That is because I didn't want to. I mean,
no, because they don't make any particular.
The detailed algebraic work that is done in that time is phenomenal. Mathematics and astronomy rises to great heights after Aryabhata. Okay, after Aryabhata 500 AD, Ujjain becomes a center of studies. Ujjain is also zero longitude, and a whole bunch of scholars come up. To the extent that Aryabhata is 500 AD, but he influences the Kerala school of 1300 AD, which also squares by Aryabhatiya. They say we study Aryabhatiya. So the influence is there and the traditions continue. By about 1300-1400 AD, Indian kings fight amongst themselves so much that each of them is a little kingdom and none of them have the resources to support something like the Kerala school. So the whole thing goes into
decay.
So all those traditions continue. I haven't mentioned simply because already he would have killed me if I had included those things. I have already spread over an hour and I wanted to give a broader view rather than. So that's why I did. It is not that they are not great, it is just that I was looking for a much broader view.
Have you written any book on this?
We have written, actually if you are interested in the subject, there is one book which we have written called Origin and Growth of Astronomy, Perspectives on Origin and Growth of Astronomy in India. Unfortunately, National Council of Science Museum just published it. It's a very popular account, you can read it, but it's not available on sale. So if you want a copy, you write to me, I'll give you a copy. The second book that we have written actually is a proper textbook of archaeoastronomy in India, which covers all aspects of archaeoastronomy. Again, it's right now private circulation. We hope to publish formally soon. But that gives that is written by some 16, 17 people. There are 30 odd chapters. Each of them gives you perspective on one of the aspects of the astronomy that I talked about. So that's a proper textbook for.
We should know the names of them.
So one is called Origin.
And your email address.
Yes, my email address is, there are not too many Vyas in the world. So if you say Vaya to Google, it gets you to me. Me and my brother are the only two people.
Vaya@gmail.com.
Vaya@gmail.com.
This number of
Vyas. Yes, there are only two of them.
Vaya is Vaya. So
that will take a few different. No. Apparently, the word comes from Lahia, writers. And my parents, I come from, I don't like to discuss this, but I come from a Nagar Brahmin family. And the tradition was that they were the record keepers of the great kings. So that's how the surname comes. And in fact, they used to alternate. So the Vaiya's sons were Mehta's and Mehta's sons were Vaiya's and Vaiya's sons were Mehta's and so on. Until my father said, nothing going, we'll continue with the same family.
These lectures are being produced on Facebook these days. And while this was being produced on Facebook, somebody asked this question on WhatsApp, that whether there is any book available on this. So it has become so instantaneous. Anyway, thank you, Mayank. Vaiya, Mehta, whatever it is. Good. Next month, on 18th of May, third Friday, there will be a lecture on management of solid waste. And one Mr. Asolkar will address this particular question, because this is becoming a very serious problem throughout our country. And I was told that not only throughout our country, but throughout the world. And how it's to be handled. Municipality suggesting something is happening. But then let us see what the management experts say on that. Thank you very much.